We the people will not take it any longer.
The fact is, everyone doesn't have to be afraid of this virus.
From protectors of the people to punishers of the people, blue cities and states are going overboard enforcing their lockdowns. Over the weekend, Mayor Lori Lightfoot of Chicago gave this warning.
We will shut you down. We will cite you. And if we need to, we will arrest you. Don't make us treat you like a criminal. But if you act like a criminal and you violate the law and you refuse to do what is necessary to save lives in the city in the middle of a pandemic, we will take you to jail, period.
She also yelled at a small group of teens hanging out in a parking lot across the street. And then in New York City, things got violent as NYPD officers were forcefully arresting a couple for allegedly violating social distancing rules. One of the cops split off and threatened a bystander with a taser before brutally beating him to the ground. What is going on? Over in Maryland, a GOP state rep says the state police threatened to arrest him if he spoke at a rally hosted by my next guest. Joining me now is Tim Walters, founder of Reopen of Maryland, and Harmeet Dhillon, civil rights attorney, founder of the Center for American Liberty, filing a lot of these actions in California. Tim, did the state police really threaten to arrest that state rep for speaking at your event? What the heck?
Yeah, it's absolutely true. And Delegate Cox has even submitted that as evidence in his in our federal lawsuit. It's strange days in Maryland.
Well, and Governor Larry Hogan, I think, did praise President Trump today or yesterday, offered some positive comments about what the president was trying to do to help all the states, which is great. But I can tell you from my little informal survey, Harmeet Dhillon, people in the Maryland, Virginia, West, I mean, they're done with this. I mean, they want to be safe and careful, but they are done. They want to save their livelihoods and their children's learning. Harmeet, you've been doing this.
Absolutely, Laura.
You've been doing these lawsuits all up and down California.
We have eight lawsuits. We filed our eighth lawsuit today, and tomorrow we'll be filing a lawsuit in another jurisdiction, one of those blue states, Laura, on behalf of an Orthodox Jewish congregation that is being discriminated against by officials. And so, Laura, what we're finding is that I think at the beginning of this, everybody was giving the government the benefit of the doubt. But as we've seen these numbers dive, thankfully, we are seeing the repression increase on a daily basis, and it's becoming very petty, arbitrary, tyrannical, and needless to say, unconstitutional. So with respect to the situation in Maryland, we have the same thing here in California. The governor has banned all protest, which is unconstitutional. And I'll be having a temporary restraining order hearing with the federal court on Thursday on that. And two beach lawsuits that we filed, another one today in federal court. Laura, it is arbitrary. It is like the mean teacher in school who punishes you for something that you didn't do. And it's just not right. And we are all adults, and it doesn't work.
Well, here in Maryland, Governor Hogan has political aspirations, and they supersede anything else. We're seeing exactly that. He's bypassing every constitution at this article at the state and federal level, and he's never made the case for the emergency that he is morally claimed as the high ground to lock everything down, and more importantly, to decide who's essential and who's not essential. It's mind-blowing.
Well, Harmeet, Governor Cuomo up in New York thinks that folks should be punished now for not wearing a mask.
Mm-hmm. It's a statewide order that I put in place that I'm proud of. I think local government should enforce it, and I think there should be a penalty. Because you could literally kill someone. You could literally kill someone because you didn't want to wear a mask. I mean, how cruel and irresponsible would that be?
Harmeet, can't wait till the science switches back on this one. Like, there's like 312 different examinations of whether you can get it in a quick passing someone on the street outside. And I think the answer to that is infinitesimally small chance.
Yeah, that's right. There's no science here, Laura, but what there is emotion and manipulation, mass hysteria, and out-of-control power-mongering by these people. The next thing they're going to do, and they're already trying to do in Kansas City, is ask for information from churchgoers and start tracing them. This is private information going back to the civil rights era when liberals tried to harass members of the NAACP. They can't get our private information, and they will abuse it. What's next? AA members and their contact information? So, Laura, this is a massive crisis. crisis, and it is not going to stop until courts begin to put a stop to it.
Well, Tim and Harmeet, keep on keeping on. But these churches that turn over their lists of parishioners, well, they're given the rope to hang them with. I mean, I don't know why they would ever do that, but it's always for security and safety purposes only. That's how it always rolls.
You know, as a police officer, I'm compelled to make this video. I've been in law enforcement for 10 years, and I'm speaking to my peers, other fellow officers, people in any kind of law enforcement position. I've seen officers nationwide enforce entire orders against the people. And I'm hoping it's the minority of officers, but I'm not sure anymore, because every time I turn on the television, every time I look to the internet, I'm seeing people arrested or cited for going to church, for traveling on the roadways, for going surfing, opening their businesses, going to the park with their families, or doing nails out of their own house, using their own house as a place of business, and having undercover agents go there and arrest them and charge them with what? With a crime? I don't know what crime people are committing by doing nails in their own house, but we're seeing this more and more and more, and we need to start looking at ourselves as officers and thinking, is what I'm doing right? Now, I want to remind you that regardless of where you stand on the coronavirus, we don't have the authority to do those things to people just because a mayor or a governor tells you otherwise. I don't care if it's your sergeant or your chief of police. We don't get to violate people's constitutional rights because somebody in our chain of command tells us otherwise. It's not how this country works. Those are de facto arrests. You know, we're violating people's rights and taking money from them, or even worse, arresting them and depriving them of their freedom when they are exercising their constitutional rights. So let's talk about that. Let's read something right here off of the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal. Among these, we have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their power from the consent of the governed, meaning our power and any government official's power is derived from the people. Okay? We don't hold power over our citizens. It's contradictory to everything that our country stands for. And this is what I'm seeing. First Amendment rights, telling people they can't go to church, freedom of religion. Okay? Telling people they can't protest, freedom of assembly. Fourth Amendment violations, illegal traffic stops to check for papers. What are you, the Gestapo? Is this 1930s Nazi Germany? You don't get to stop people unless you have reasonable suspicion or probable cause that they have committed a crime. And I know people that have personally been stopped saying, we want to see papers showing that you're essential.
David, you copy a phone call.
That is not how our job works. Okay? What really has been pissing me off lately is the fact that these officers that are going out here and enforcing these tyrannical orders, what they're doing is they're putting my job and my safety at risk. Because what you're doing is you're widening the gap between public trust and law enforcement officers. And what that's going to do is it's going to, I mean, look at what's happened to law enforcement in the last 10 years. Less and less public trust, and more often than not, that is a result of isolated incidents that get blown out of proportion. They're not isolated anymore. They're happening every single day. And the thing that I want you guys to realize is that our power that we hold as law enforcement officers is nothing more than a facade. It's a badge and a gun. And people, you don't realize, if you haven't lived in anarchy, if you haven't seen combat, things can be stripped from people in a heartbeat. And that's what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid that these actions are going to wake a sleeping giant, i.e. the American people, okay? They are going to be put in a position where they won't have their rights trampled anymore. And us as law enforcement officers, we'll have our ability to enforce the law stripped from us in about 10 minutes, okay? I think what is going to happen if this continues is we're going to see bloodshed in the streets, okay? I don't want to see bloodshed in the streets on either side of this coin. I don't want to see fellow officers get injured or killed, and I certainly don't want to see citizens get injured or killed. And I promise you, most of you out there doing these tyrannical acts against our citizens, you're not ready for combat. You're not mentally or physically ready for combat in the first place. I promise you, you don't want to go through that, and I hope I never have to go through that again. You know, you don't get to just say, well, I'm doing this because I was told to do so, or I'm following orders, or I need to keep this job. Guess what? I need to keep this job. Anybody. I have 3 young children. I have 2 houses. Like, I have the same sob story that the rest of you guys have. But my personal choices and my living arrangements, no matter what they are, don't allow me to trample on people's rights. And I don't understand why that concept is so hard for people to understand. Listen, you need to stand up for what's right. You need to, if you're part of a department or an agency that is asking people or asking their officers or their deputies to impose on people's rights and infringe on their freedoms, you need to step up and say, no, that's not me. That's not what I signed up for, and that's going against my oath. And if that costs you your job, so be it. At least you'll be able to look at yourself in the mirror at night. I've already expressed this to my department, and luckily for me, I come from a department that I feel like my chain of command shares my view, but I don't care what department you're part of or what your chain of command thinks. You don't get to trample on people's liberty. And so, you know, as a special operations veteran, I've fought on the streets of Iraq for under the U.S. government's guise of freedom. And I'm telling you what, the American people are going to be, you are going to wake a sleeping giant. And they are going to fight 10 times harder for their freedom on their soil than anything you've ever seen before. And if that's something you're willing to face, then keep trampling on people's rights. But I promise you, the American spirit of defiance is going to rise again, and it's going to be a big problem for our country. So I'll leave you with this, something that I learned as an E-nothing in the Army. No matter what situation you're put in, if you look inside yourself and ask yourself one question, am I doing the right thing? You ask yourself that, you know the answer. And no amount of money or no order or law or anything should be able to make you go against doing the right thing. So I'm imploring officers to look inside themselves and ask themselves, is this what I want to be doing to my citizens? And I think the answer is clear. And if we all stand up together, guess what? It'll be a non-issue, no factor, because people and law enforcement will be united like we should be.
Well, look at that. No social distancing happening here. In fact, this group of people in Huntington Beach right now is protesting the stay-at-home orders.
Organizers also held a demonstration this morning and said they want to, quote, claim our lives back, and that they believe the nation is being lied to. Huntington Beach police are monitoring the situation, but so far we have not seen any arrests.
There are other countries that if you had a pre-existing condition, and let's say the virus caused you to go to the ICU and then have a heart or kidney problem, some countries are recording that as a heart issue or a kidney issue and not a COVID-19 death. Right now, we're still recording it, and we'll I mean, the great thing about having forms that come in and a form that has the ability to market as COVID-19 infection, the intent is right now that those, if someone dies with COVID-19, we are counting that.
Anyone who has COVID when they pass away will be included in that category. Dr. Ngozi Ezike explained this does not mean the virus caused that death, but if someone does test positive for COVID before dying, that is classified a coronavirus fatality.
You were in hospice and had already been given, you know, a few weeks to live, and then you also were found to have COVID, that would be counted as a COVID death. It means that if, technically, even if you died of a clear alternate cause, but you had COVID at the same time, it's still listed as a COVID death. So everyone who's listed as a COVID death doesn't mean that that was the cause of the death, but they had COVID at the time of death.
I'm up on stage.
60,000 deaths.
And all the rage I feel inside of me.
50 states, 50 plans is an experiment that will now play out for months.
I hate it when they lie to me and they're dying to see. So I'm trying to be what they want to see. But they're hunting me. Don't know what they want from me.
So here I am again, running amok. My luck is up, I'm stuck like Chuck. My brain's been picked and plucked, I'm fucked. My mortal enemy is stuck in a portal sending me luck. Flocks of sounds and cages. Nouns merge with verbs and an urge to disturb my pages. And that enrages the writer's block engages. Deaf and dumb thespians take the silent stages. With their cobweb throats, they can't sing any notes. So the audience begins dispersing. The actors get pissed, they start cursing. They're tired of rehearsing. They're ready to do the damn show. They're ready to go. You know what I mean? Fuck the quarantine. Fuck COVID-19. Fuck a fucking vaccine. Social engineering at the center stage. About to go full circle when we turn the page. Miss Deborah Birx, you old bitch. Putting COVIDs on obits and certificates. It's ridiculous. We should be enraged and irate at our newfound fate and change the current state of mind controls. As Mr. Gates pulls the levers of power from his ivory tower, he is a Zionist, a mad scientist. With unlimited funds, we need to run or we need to get some more guns. And we need to do that shit while it's possible. Cause pretty soon, I swear, it's not gonna be optional. Are you hearing me? The wealthy be stealthy, ushering in this tyranny. I don't want a mask, give me an Uzi. I want my freedom. I wanna be some frog in a stovetop jacuzzi. The temp of the water getting hotter, cannon fodder like lambs to the slaughter. Every American, grab your sons and your daughters. Go outside, get you some vitamin D and some sunshine. Everything seems just fine. Look at Sweden. They didn't shut down shit. Nobody's dying. Not any more than any other year. They let that shit go in and go right out the other ear. I wish that we could do it here, but we so full of fear. They might hurt you if you break curfew.
And then the final solution,
which is a year to 2 years off, is the vaccine. So we've got to go full speed ahead on all three fronts.
Eventually, what we'll have to have is certificates of who's a recovered person, who's a vaccinated person, because you don't want people moving around the world where you'll have some countries that won't have it under control, sadly.
And then the final solution.
Just to head off the conspiracy theorist. Maybe we shouldn't call the vaccine the final solution. Maybe just the
good
best
point.
Solution. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
The return to normal solution.
Exactly.
8 weeks ago, our public health officer and the governor participated in something never done before in our nation's history. Our civil liberties and constitutional protections were placed on hold.
My name is Dr. Cordy Williams. I practice right between San Diego and LA.
I chose to come here today
because I knew I had to take a stand for liberty.
I'm here representing thousands of physicians across the country whose voices are being silenced because we don't agree with the mainstream media and the experts who are telling us what to do.
From the beginning, I told you that I would not be enforcing the stay-at-home order. I knew that they could be trusted to act as responsible adults, and I was correct.
The Declaration of Independence in our U.S. Constitution was never designed to restrain the people. It was designed to restrain the government. Governor Newsom has stepped on our liberties and our freedoms.
In the face of tyranny, in the face of freedom, are you going to sit there in your riot gear against peaceful protesters, or are you going to say, you know what? It's time to stand up for my country. Because I took an oath of office and it said I will defend all enemies, foreign and domestic.
The original projections and fears that caused these orders to be put into place have been proven wrong. Out of 2.5 million people in Riverside County, we have only 2,300 residents positive with this virus. That is less than 0.1%. Our future success depends on the leadership of our county to make decisions based on facts and data, not projections and fear.
As we see the statistics come in, we're realizing that the fatality rate of this virus is in the ballpark of a bad seasonal influenza.
Without other serious medical issues, the danger of this virus is significantly lowered, if not eliminated. Not only do we not have the resources to enforce unreasonable orders, I refuse to make criminals out of business owners, single moms, and otherwise healthy individuals for exercising their constitutional rights.
Never in the history of this great republic have we quarantined the healthy. Just like other respiratory viral illnesses in the past, we get over this virus by achieving herd immunity. We can never achieve herd immunity by keeping the herd quarantined. It's time that we protect the vulnerable and the most at risk, but we allow the young and the healthy to open the doors and go back to work. This government-imposed cure is going to be worse than the virus itself.
Now is the time for you to decide. What side of history do you want to be on? I'm serious. Somebody's going to ask you that question.
We the people will not take it any longer.
The fact is, everyone doesn't have to be afraid of this virus.
Truly leading is always about taking the first step to stand up when morally and ethically you don't feel like something is right. Leadership is in the force of fear, in the force of uncertainty.
There cannot be a new normal. We are talking about a country formed on the fundamental freedoms of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Any new normal is a direct attack on those basic rights which set us apart and make us the greatest country in the world.
Do not let your voices be silenced.
Yeah.